Years and years of research and study had led to this very moment. A man by the name of Calvin Shepard was laying on an aluminum operating table, waiting for his colleagues to throw the switch. A switch that would finally solve the answer to the question that has plagued humanity for years. What lies beyond the laws of physics? This project had pushed the boundaries of what we knew about quantum physics, how we interacted with subatomic particles and even the multiverse. With the aid of incredibly strong magnets, these scientists were able to create an exact duplicate of an electron, allowing two people to see one particle behave in two ways at once. Effectively, they were doing the impossible. As small as it was, they were bringing in a particle that didn't exist in our timeline. Once this was accomplished, on the micro scale, they began upping the size, duplicating larger and larger objects, increasing in molecular complexity. The most controversial of the experiments amongst the isolated group was recreating a lab mouse. The clone lasted all of 10 seconds before it quite literally turned into a puddle of biological ooze. It was discovered that the magnetic devices had to both alter the behavior and stabilize the atomic system of the object. After several tweaks in the circuits, which by this point were nearly vaporized, they had finally mastered the process, successfully cloning another mouse and having it stay together long after it was brought into this universe. The population of test animals quite literally doubled, with the process now deemed understood and the results from it having long-term success. They moved on to the most risky of operations, human testing. Their government-funded research would never allow for outsourcing of human subjects. Their higher-ups didn't even know they had succeeded in the slightest yet. It was then that Mr. Shepard stepped forward. He was a younger man, in his mid-30s. Minor protests were raised in concern for him, but he insisted he take the leap for everyone else. Weeks of preparation were taken. Calvin was put on an all-liquid diet to avoid free-moving solids from interfering with the process. His will was written and notarized, a false cause of death was prepared, complete obliteration by one of the many blast doors in the underground facility. This cause of death would be plausible given the chance that his body might liquefy. Finally, the hour of truth, the moment of complete understanding. Needless to say, the entire team was on edge. All but two stayed in a shelter room across the complex. The duo would oversee the experiment should anything catastrophically go wrong. Only 3 out of 10 scientists would die, presumably. They asked if Shepard was ready. He gave the thumbs up. Stage 1. Draw power. The whole complex dimmed. Stage 2. Cycle the magnets. Loud whirling noise came from large hunks of charged metal on either side of him. Stage 3. Prime the electron field. The view of Shepard began to become distorted from behind the protective blast shield. Final stage. Blast Calvin Shepard with a magnetic field strong enough to separate iron from steel. What Shepard experienced on that table could only be described as mind-shattering. He was almost able to feel the iron globules in his blood being tugged at. The devices reached peak strength. Both rooms began to shake as the devices rumbled from their coils being spun at millions of rotations per minute. Despite the analog nature of the instruments, the monitoring scientists found it difficult to manipulate the dials and buttons, since their steel structure was being harshly pulled at. The electron field surrounding Shepard flashed with a blinding light. Then it disappeared in an instant with Calvin in tow. That wasn't supposed to happen. The electron field would glow like that, which they had prepared for, but it nor the subject ever disappeared. The 7 others braced themselves against the tremor sweeping the room. Then it simply stopped. 10 seconds later, the shelter's evacuation sirens blared. Six of them headed for the exit. The seventh man, James, rushed to the experiment room. As he ran through the corridors, he could feel pulses of energy reverberating through the building. The floor under him felt as if it was shifting and rolling within the waves. As he drew near the room, James saw the concrete walls were melting. Reaching the door, his confusion grew worse. There was a pile of rocks laying at the entrance. The instruments were gone. In their place, piles of iron ore, ingots, and other materials, some in states of extreme decay, others shining like new. And then he saw the ooze. Near the testing room door was what looked like a pile of biological fluid pooled on the floor. A decrepit voice called out, "You have to turn them back on." It cried out as loudly as it could. He glanced left and caught the sight of a wrinkled old man slumped against the wall, unable to stand. With another pulse of energy, suddenly the man appeared to be in his mid-40s. It was the eldest of the two, Jackson, who oversaw Shepard's experiment. "Hurry up, before we all die," he yelled, much louder this time. A pulse wave hit them again, and the man disintegrated into dust before James's eyes. James peered into the room. Bright light was flickering throughout, making it hard to tell what had happened. And then he heard it.
"You don't have much time. I can't hold your point for long. Send me back."
James was utterly silent, staring at the warping anomaly on the other side of the glass. His mind was breaking itself, trying to understand what stood before him. Another pulse shook the building. He could feel his skin becoming loose. He was rapidly aging.
"No."
The voice rang out, shifting and warping the space around the anomaly as it did. James began the process again. Last shift had rebuilt the controls, allowing him to get the magnets running, albeit slower this time. His muscles on fire and his bones creaking. The magnets spun up, and the electron field enveloped the ethereal shape. Within seconds, the room began to tremble. A vortex appeared behind the anomaly, pulling it in, bringing half the room with it. A final wave of distorting energy ran through the building. The pain in James's bones and muscles faded. He was back to himself. But this experiment was not without its losses. Considered a catastrophic failure. He made his way out of the facility, slowly joining the others. He couldn't say what exactly he had saw. Hell, he didn't even understand it. James killed himself within a year. I felt a tugging in my body, like these machines were trying to rip me apart. It would probably be better if they did, honestly. I felt the electron cloud around me begin to boil and increase in temperature. I called out to them to stop the experiment, but the room began to shake, drowning out my voice. The cloud erupted in light so blinding that not even my eyelids could shield me from it. Thankfully, I didn't have to endure it for long, as I was crushed instantly by the cloud collapsing into itself. I don't know how long I was out, but when I came to, I was suspended in a void. I could see nothing, hear nothing, or feel anything. I couldn't even speak. It was then that I was blasted with a sound so loud it could rip apart galaxies. A light so intense it could scorch even the hottest quasar. I should have gone deaf or blind or at the very least died. But no. Somehow I persisted. I realized what I was seeing. The beginning of the universe. The intensity of the first seconds of life. Once I understood this, I was propelled through space and time at such speeds it would put light to shame. I saw everything. Stars, planets, solar systems, and galaxies form. I saw life on other planets grow and die. I saw the beginning and the end of not only this universe, but all of them. I could see every instance of every timeline of every multiverse unfold in front of me at once. I spent countless eons witnessing the whole of reality and more. For a time, I believe I went mad as my mind was reformed and built into a mechanism that could understand what I was experiencing. It was then that I was halted and pulled back down. I traveled through some sort of wormhole when I found myself inside the testing room I was in trillions of years ago, though I suspect it was mere seconds to them. Every atom I saw, I could see its entire existence at once, and when I saw it in a different chronological state, reality was shifted to suit my perception. I saw my two colleagues rushing around inside their control room, attempting to figure out what had happened before they paused in utter disbelief at me. I am unsure what it is they saw of me, but I could see them. All of them. Every point in their existence. The youngest of the two, Mason, rushed for the door to this room, but I unfortunately saw him in a point in time before he was even born, causing him to revert into a puddle of stem cells. The eldest, Jackson, I tried to focus on the him that was right in front of me. I had to be sent back. Before Jackson realized he needed to reactivate the devices, I was unable to remain focused and saw him as an old man, changing reality to suit. The controls in front of him were thrown around, changed to their base components, decayed beyond recognition. Process couldn't be started again unless I changed that. That's when it occurred to me. What I was. What I was doing. They can only perceive time as a change in matter. A piece of metal rusting shows that time has passed. That the matter is decaying. Entropy. Entropy is the rusting of reality. Time is a poison to lower dimensions. Destroying matter. I was bringing a full dose of toxins into my past reality. I saw James come through the now non-existent steel door, all just raw materials. He saw the state of the other two. I attempted to shift Jackson back so he could tell James what to do or fix it himself. The message was clear. But before he could attempt it himself, I lost focus again and accelerated him 80 years into his future, causing him to turn to dust. I dared not speak up until that point in fear of what I would do, but my form was too shocking to James for him to act. With all the concentration I could gather, I kept my eyes on his current state and spoke what I could. However, my voice alone was shifting time and reality. I halted James's aging as much as I could before he started the devices again. They activated, and I could feel myself leaving this plane. The wormhole opened, and I took the machines with me.